Distributive property. Let's pretend that you are planning to go on a trip for 3 days. One of the most important things that you need to pack for your trip is clothes. And an outfit is made out of a shirt plus a set of pants. Well, if you're going on a 3-day trip, you need 3 groups of shirts and pants. So in math, we would write that like 3 times the shirts and the pants. So we need, this is saying, we need 3 outfits together. Well, you could find out how many pieces of clothes that is in 2 different ways. You could add together 1 shirt and 1 pant to get 2, so that's 2 pieces of clothes in an outfit, and then multiply that by 3 to get 6. Well, there's another way that you can do it and get the same answer. You can also say, I'm going to have 3 shirts, so multiply the 3 outfits times 1 shirt in an outfit, and I'm going to have 3 pants, and then I'm going to add that amount together to also get 6. That's a really simple way to explain what the distributive property is doing. Here is the definition. I wrote it on a balance scale, and then we'll see a math example, number example, down here under the balance. So the distributive property says that multiplying a sum by a number gives the same result as multiplying each addend by the number and then adding the products. Now that is a crazy definition. So let's go back and look at the example, see if we can figure out what that really means, okay? Multiplying a sum, there's the sum, 4 plus 2. Sum means adding something together. So multiplying some sum times a number. So I'm gonna get the sum here and multiply it by a number is gonna give us the same as whatever this is over here. So we have a balance scale, and this method matches this method. We're looking at the same kind of thing as the associative and the commutative property, where we can do something 2 different ways and still get the same answer. So keep that in mind. We're thinking about a balance scale. It's 2 ways to do the same thing. So on the opposite side, this is the same as multiplying each addend. An addend is the things that you add together. So we're talking about 4 and we're talking about 2 as the addends by the number. Remember, the number was 3. So let's see that piece. I multiplied this addend times 3. Here it is. And I multiplied the other addend times 3. One way that you can see that is sort of like distributing the 3 over the 4 and over the 2. So I like to draw lines like this and say I'm doing 3 times 4, and then I'm also doing 3 times 2. There it is, 3 times 4 and 3 times 2. So I multiplied each addend by the number and then adding the products. Products are the answer to a multiplication problem. So I got this answer to a multiplication problem and this answer to a multiplication problem, and then I added them together. This is gonna give me the same answer as this. Let's go back and prove it. Parentheses means do this first. 4 times 2 is 6, times 3 will be 18. This side of the balance will give me 18. Over here, 3 times 4 is 12, 3 times 2 is 6. When I add those together, I also get 18. So let's use the distributive property in 2 different examples. I have here a sum that I'm going to multiply by a number. Remember, if you stick a number right up beside a parenthesis, that's the same as meaning multiplying that number times the sum. So the distributive property says to distribute that 3 over each of the addends. Multiply that number by each of the addends. So I'm going to do 3 times 4 by distributing the 3 to the 4. And I'm going to do the 3 times 5. Then I'm going to add both of those products together, and I would get the exact same answer. Over here, let's mentally check that. 4 plus 5 would be 9, times 3 would be 27. Over here, 4 times 3 is 12, 3 times 5 is 15, and 12 plus 15 does make 27. So we have modeled the distributive property correctly. Here, we can work the distributive property backwards. We can see that both of these, inside both of these parentheses, we're multiplying 4 times something. So 4, we could sort of pull it out. Here we're distributing it over on this first problem. We could sort of pull a 4 out and think about that this would give us the same answer as if we multiplied the 4 times the sum of these two numbers, 8 plus 6. So when I evaluated or simplified this, it would give us the same as this here. Next, I can also use the distributive property to solve a problem like this. You could possibly do this problem in your head thanks to the distributive property. So let's turn it into a number multiplied by a sum. So I can do 9 times, and then I can turn 23 into a sum that's easy to work with, like expanded form. 20 plus 3. So I wrote 23 in expanded form. And now I could do these multiplication problems in my head. I could do 9 times 20. That would be distributing the 9 over the 20. And then I could distribute the 9 over the 3. 9 times 3. Those are both multiplication problems I can do in my head. Thanks to the zeros trick, I would do 9 times 2 is 18. Add a 0. 9 times 7 is 63. And then I could add those up. That is a little hard to do in your head. So 180, I'm going to go ahead and write it here and check it. 243. So we use the distributive property to solve this problem. I hope that some light bulbs are going off and you're thinking, this looks oddly familiar to something we've done before. Well, you have. Remember when we did the area codes practice? That's where we had sheets and we were filling grids up with base 10 blocks and then dividing them into rectangles. And also, it was a lot like the partial products method to solve multiplication. You were really doing the distributive property, you just didn't know it. So we took a number like 4 times 37, and we broke it up into a sum, 30 plus 7, that was expanded form. And then, so here it is, I had the 4 and broke it into 30 plus 7. Here's the group of 30, here's the group of 7. And then I multiplied or distributed the 4 times the 30 here. Here it is too, 4 times 30. And then I distributed the 4 times the 7. Here it is here, 4 times 7. Then I did the multiplication problem here and added them up. So I'm actually using the distributive property when I take this 4, multiply it by the 30, and multiply it by the 7. And that's modeled here. If you've made it all the way to lesson 6 on hands-on equations, you're also doing the distributive property in that lesson. You see something like this, and you can think of it two ways. You can think of it by doing two x's, this is two x's, plus a 1 cube, and then that means this 2 out on the outside means to double what's on the inside. So we show it like this by stacking them on top of each other. But you also could have thought about it by doubling the x's, so think of two x's and two x's, and then doubling that 1 by putting 1 and 1. It doesn't matter which order you do it in, it still gives you 4 x's and 2. So you could do this whole thing twice, or you could do the 2 distributed here and get 4 x's, and the 2 distributed here to get 2. So that's using the distributive property here. We're going to do two problems to practice what we know about the distributive property. So the question says, which of the following expressions is equivalent to 4 and 1/10 times the sum of, notice this is multiply when it's stuck right up beside it, 8 and 5/10 plus 6 and 2/10. So we're going to go through each of these examples. One will be right, and we'll find out what's wrong with the other three. You know that you're going to be looking for something where the 4 and 1/10 is multiplied by 8 and 5/10, and the 4 and 1/10 is multiplied by 6 and 2/10. So here right away I can see that I have this multiplication, the second multiplication problem happening, but I don't have 4 and 1/10 times 8 and 5/10. So A is not correct. Here I got the first multiplication problem that I wanted. See that one here? But I don't have 4 and 1/10 times the 6 and 2/10, so that doesn't work. Let's look at this one. 4 1/10 times 8 5/10. Remember that dot can mean multiply. Added together with the 4 1/10 times 6 2/10. That one is looking good. So let's go and see if we can find what's wrong with this one to confirm that this is the correct answer. Here I have 4 1/10 and 8 5/10, except for that they're not multiplied by each other. I added them, and that's not gonna give me the same answer as if I multiply this times this one. So you need to correct this one, it would have to have multiplied here and multiplied here. Since it doesn't, that is not the right answer, and we would choose C as our best choice. This is the one modeling the distributive property. And finally, this story models the distributive property. Show how. Kevin and Rob gave 9 baseball cards to each of their friends. So here's Kevin and here's Rob, and they have some amount of friends. Every single friend of theirs is going to get 9 baseball cards. Here's some more information. Kevin has 2 friends, and Rob has 5 friends. That's in green. How many baseball cards did they give away? Well, the distributive property says we could solve that problem 2 ways and still get the same answer. We could first add together how many friends they have. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or in other words, 2 + 5 makes 7. And then we could multiply those number of friends times 9 cards apiece, 9 and 9 and 9. Instead of doing repeated addition, we could do 9 times 7 and get 63 baseball cards. But we could solve that another way. We could multiply 9 times 2. See how we're distributing this 9 times the 2 and distributing this 9 over the 5? We could find out the 9 times the 2 represents Kevin's number of baseball cards that he's giving away, because he has 9 cards given to each of his 2 friends. So he's going to give away a total of 18 cards. And then we could do Rob's total number of cards that he's giving away. He's got 5 friends and he's giving each one of them 9, so that would be 45. Then if we know that Kevin's giving away 18, Rob is giving away 45, if we add them together, we will get 63, and we will see that the distributive property does work.